Okay, let's get out some papers so we can take our midterms. Oh, welcome back. How's it going? Just kidding. We are going to talk about punishment today, what it is, how effective it is. Sort of theory behind punishment, does it work? And we can look into some groups and figure out if we can come up with some management plans to alter behavior using punishment. Right, so when we're talking about reinforcements, right? Thinking of the theory of learning. Right, and this theory of learning, when it comes to reinforcements, usually comes from Skinner's observation of really, in field psychology, there really isn't a thing dealing with learning, but really altering behaviors, right? But here we say, we learn to change behavior. We learn by either rewarding or punishing. We do this by adding or subtracting. Right? All right, and adding or subtracting is dealing with positive reinforcement, negative reinforcement, or positive punishment, negative. Adding something to punish or taking away something to punish. Now, the whole theory really behind this concept and idea is that human beings, particularly, have a continuous life filled with a conflict. So when we think of the larger picture of behavior, think that, well, we are alive and we are active. We are experiencing new things. Since we are experiencing things on a continuous basis, then we are taking out of comfort. So there seems to be a lifelong enduring conflict just for the fact of being alive. Because we say when you're born with homeostatic balance. You're born in a state of homeostasis. And you're taken out of homeostasis whenever something in the outside environment alters homeostasis. Right? If you're hungry, you gotta eat. Bring yourself back to homeostatic balance. If you feel a desire that doesn't get fulfilled, there's an enduring conflict, lifelong one, that leads us to want to move towards pleasure. Right? And so Freud talked about pleasure principle. Really, that's the driving, motivating factor for possibly all of life, is to constantly seek pleasure. Right? Or at the least, be in homeostatic balance. Thus, we either add or we subtract things from our life in order to achieve pleasure and alter the behavior as such. Right? Remember, we think in theory that the only way to change behavior long term is to make things pleasurable. Right? So we have an enduring conflict. So as we talked about positive reinforcements, now we're kind of talking about punishment and reinforcement behaviors, right? Negative and positive. So we have things like differential reinforcement of others. We have things like extinction, right? How do we go about getting rid of a behavior altogether, we will review that. Differential reinforcement of others, which means, again, example here, rewarding a child when inappropriate behavior does not occur. Right? So giving reward when bad behavior doesn't occur. Right? And we also have DRI, which is incompatible behavior, right? Differential reinforcement of incompatible behavior. Ignoring bad behavior rewarding good. One of the examples given was a child is in class and they constantly get up out of their seat. What do you as a teacher would do? Maybe you ignore them getting out of their seat. Right? You ignore because maybe they're seeking attention as some sort of stimulus. Maybe it brings them pleasure to seek attention. And you will reward when they come back and sit in the seat. So we said punishment, we have a stimulus presented after response that suppresses or weakens a response. So we're dealing with punishment, all we're trying to do is weaken or suppress a response to something, right? So a stimulus. And that verse of stimulus here is an event described as unpleasant. So we say of anything that find to be unpleasant, it is an aversive stimulus. A loud sound that gives us anxiety. In conversations with a person we don't want to talk to. Right? Maybe even particular things we ingest into our bodies that we would describe as unpleasant. And these aversive stimulus are sometimes the same as the punishment. So they also can be used. Now, punishment can be conditioned or unconditioned. Right? So we say ignoring is a form of punishment. Human beings do not like being isolated.
This upcoming school.
Animals. Thus, if a human being is a social animal and they're experiencing socialization and one ignores them in the socialization process, that becomes unpleasant. Right? And that unpleasant feeling is described as a punishment. Frowning, right? They give an example here. We respond to facial features, we respond to body language, we respond to negative energies that we sense, we respond to all sorts of things that others exhibit to us. Frowning is one, right? So frowning can bring anxiety to us in some way, and be deemed as unpleasant. In F in a class, they give an example, right? The only reason why you're here in class is to achieve a marginally decent grade so you can move on to the next, right? Or for the most part, you just want to take a class you find it interesting. Now, if you were to receive a bad grade, it would be a form of punishment for you for not exhibiting certain behaviors, right? So you say, hey, really, is it about learning? Is going to college really about learning, or is it shaping you to be a certain way, to think a certain way? Right? We say just thinking is altering the behavior of thoughts. Right? We're altering the behavior of thoughts, so we don't even really know if we're truly learning anything at all. It may just be a byproduct of shaping. Right? You have a question? Okay, problem when a therapist administers punishment. Do you think it's appropriate for a therapist to administer punishment? What are your thoughts? Think that's ethical? If you're a social worker, school counselor, therapist, applied behavior analyst, something of the sort, would you administer punishment as part of your methodology for changing behavior?
Yes.
What do you think? Appropriate or inappropriate? Right, maybe it depends. Right, we said what kind of punishment. just mental exercises or something like that. It may not be as bad, but it's something physical, we probably would have a problem with that. Alright, so we say negative punishment and positive punishment. Positive is always adding, negative is always taking away. So here we say taking away something, such as a fine, right? Which is taking away money from your pockets, right? No smartphone, taking away your phone to give you distress. Now, this can lead to extinction if you take away the reinforcer, ignoring the student who misbehaved. Okay? We say it's just as effective. Ignoring is just as effective because it deals with incompatible behavior. Negative punishment typically takes away something other than a reinforcer, and punishment has to be more severe than a reward for performing the act. Right? So in order for things to take shape using punishment, the punishment needs to be at least to a degree higher, more severe than the opposite, which is the reward. Now, punishment usually works quickly, more quickly than extinction. What do you believe is more effective? Right? Since we're talking about effective outcomes. What are your thoughts on what's more effective in terms of outcomes of a target behavior? Punishment or reward? What's been your observations in life? Is it more effective to change behavior using methods of punishment or methods of reward? What are your thoughts? Yes.
The reward, like you can still have like your comfortable baseline and be rewarded, and you're still not that motivated. If the reward isn't good enough, then you're not motivated to change the behavior. But if you make it uncomfortable by removing something that is pleasant, then like behavior is more likely to change.
Gotcha. So being less than baseline is more powerful than even being over, basically, right? Okay. You want to say something, somebody for that?
Yeah, I agree. I think that's more effective.
Yeah. Right, and that's probably true for the fact. Right? So we said we have baseline, or we can call it whatever you want, homeostasis, right? Right, we could say maybe punishment is more powerful because anything above baseline is maybe not even to be expected, right? Maybe just expect to be baseline, but to be below it could be perceived as experiencing high distress to get back to just that original point, right? So anything above the original point, we may not even expect to get off. So punishment seems to be a more effective approach, but it does have its negative consequences. So this is what I want you to do in groups. Let's think of a five-step punishment plan prisoners. To enforce good behavior. Let's say you are the director of a prison, right? A very violent one at that. What would be sort of a five-step punishment plan, right? What methods of punishment would you use in order to keep good behavior enforced within a prison? I'm gonna give you a couple minutes. You could be on your own, you two could be in a group, and everyone else maybe. Actually, you could be on your own, because these two would be groups since you're right next to each other. So come up with a five-step punishment plan on how to enforce good behavior in a prison. What are you gonna do to punish? Remember, we say you don't wanna punish too bad, because it can also have negative consequences. So think about the methods that you use and even the consequences of those methods, right? How a prisoner should react, will it be beneficial, et cetera, et cetera. I'll give you 5 minutes for that.
So I guess you could take away the risk of, you know, so you can't go outside.
Yeah.
All right, see what we come up with. come up with? In the back, what was your plan?
In one of my, come on, just a second, you were talking about, what happened, the specific worker, but it's when they go into, what, I don't think solitary, no.
Solitary confinement?
I don't know if that is the word, or, I think so, you might be. But obviously, that does kind of create like a negative effect, and it kind of does have to do with psychology, because they start talking to themselves, they start hurting themselves.
So isolation?
Yeah, but that wouldn't necessarily enforce the behavior, because obviously, it's a negative effect on them. But.
Okay. Isolation, anything else you have to think of? Remember, punishment could be both positive or negative reinforcement, right? So you could either give, add something or subtract something. Alright, in the middle, what were some of your thoughts?
So we thought maybe like take away courtyard time, so like say you can't go outside. Or say like you have to eat after everyone else. Or like if they have like tattoo equipment or any like anything else for recreation, take that away. Like give them a heavier workload. And then like we also mentioned.
Say give a heavier workload?
Yeah.
So add a heavier workload? Is it negative or positive, the same, add workload?
And then we also talked about solitary confinement.
You're talking about like where to put it, like, I thought it could go last just because of like, it's not very effective, and just like, they were saying like, the mental, like, basically like what it does to people on the isolation, and it's not like a, like, behavior fixer, it's just an inhibitor.
Okay, there's a, I guess inhibits. Okay, in the back, what were some of the thoughts?
So I also had taken away their yard time and also adding like more jobs to do to make them like.
Okay, so more workload.
And I also had taken away their phone privileges.
Phone privileges?
Yes. As well as, I know like some people have like, I don't know what it's called, but like when they can get like extra like snacks, like taking away.
Like commissary?
Yeah, that's what it's called, yeah. And then my last option was taking away like visitation, because.
Okay, so is there a lot of negative reinforcers for punishment? What?
I had, my first one was like search and toss their room. And then.
So is that a positive or negative reinforcer?
I would say it would be a negative.
Negative.
I was kind of thinking in terms, I was thinking of like Shawshank Redemption, like they tossed Andy's room a couple times and like messed it up to like punish him in a way.
Okay, so maybe you say negative because it's disorganized on purpose?
Yeah.
You figure it probably took a lot of work to, you're in that cell that much time, you probably organize things in a perfect way, get it clean, someone messes it up, it's gonna be unpleasant, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then I didn't put to add more work to their jobs, but to reduce or eliminate, like, I know they get a little bit of pay, like reduce or eliminate that for like a set amount of time.
Okay, so whatever pay they get.
And then I hit on, and then I'd also seen once about like a documentary, like some prison was like giving prisoners cats to like help rehabilitate them, and I was thinking like maybe give them a cat and if they act up, take the cat away.
Okay. That's interesting.
Like if they get really attached to it and they get and they misbehave.
So add a pet of some sort, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, interesting. I think that one's pretty creative. So I was also seeing that that probably is very effective, right? Because you're bonding with something that's alive. You create relationships, and we all know you have a tendency to socialize. You want to have relationships. All right, excellent job. I see a lot of just removal of things. Maybe we could thought a little bit more about adding some more positive, negative reinforcers. But maybe we think of some more creative ways. Let's look at this round table for prison. So we can see some of these methods for prison itself. Does the punishment work? Does it repeat?
It's the system described as close to breaking point. The U.S. has the world's highest incarceration rate.
So many young people end up in our criminal justice system. It's not normal.
No business would be allowed to run as poorly as our prison systems are now in this country, ever. The cost and the outcomes are abysmal.
That is punishment the only way to deal with criminals. What is the rehabilitation approach seen in some European jails the answer? And how should governments around the world deal with society's offenders? Prisons have expanded by 400% over the past 30 years in the US, with just over 2 million people locked away in some 1,800 prisons and 3,000 jails. One report found that 68% of state prisoners reoffended within 3 years after their release and 77% within five. Prison officials say years of outsourcing to the private sector has led to worsening conditions for inmates. It's led many to believe the problem has grown too large to ignore. But some European countries have a different approach, to focus not on punishment, but on rehabilitation.
There are less criminals in our prisons, because Dutch judges have started to sentence people in different ways.
In Norway, reoffences are the lowest in the world at just 20%. In the Netherlands, changing ideas about punishing criminals has seen many of its prisons standing empty. There are now only 38 prisons still in operation, 27 have been closed in the past 3 years. In Germany, up to a third of all criminal cases are diverted away from prosecution altogether. It's led to European jails being called prison utopia, but are they too soft?
It's very hard to set aside those other questions about punishment. Is it harsh enough that we're talking about? But all the evidence suggests is if you want to reduce risk, you need to use people's ability to think rationally. We tend to kind of look off fiction almost to tell us, you know, what the crime population looks like, and all murders, rapists. Reality is very, very different. And I think what you see in there in Norway and Sweden is a far greater focus on what you do with those people that have committed those low level offences. Is prison going to help, or is there another way of approaching this?
The numbers do show some success, but even if some European models are working with low level offenders, an open prison style could be seen as too accommodating for violent criminals. Prisons serve an important role protecting society from its most dangerous criminals, but in the long run, does it really act as a deterrent to would-be criminals, or is the prison system simply fueling a cycle of crime?
Okay, what are your thoughts? Is prison the answer for altering behavior? Does it rehab criminals into exhibiting more positive behaviors? Should we not be locking people away like we are doing now? Kind of letting people get free and, you know, say home arrest, stuff like that for certain crimes? Or should we be tough on crime? What are your thoughts? Tough on crime or focus on rehabilitation? Where do you stand with this in terms of what's effective? All right, so here's another management plan. Come up with some steps for carjackers in Chicago. Just think, we have an issue here with carjackings in Chicago. Give me some of your thoughts on what should be done about this issue in order to change individuals from being carjackers. Right? You say you're dealing primarily with a younger demographic. Ages range from about maybe 12 on average to about 17 or 18 years of age. Right? So people who are not necessarily adults legally. What would be your plan in order to help these individuals change their behavior? Stop carjacking. Think of some creative ways. Let's see what we come up with. All right, think of some sort of reform. Or you may say punish. So you can say give you punishment, or you're going to reward them in some way, right? This tends to be an issue, and one we haven't resolved on what to do about, right? And we have changed the behavior of the individuals from making us pay them this attention. So should we just be locking these individuals up and let them face the music for their crimes? Or could we come up with some alternative means to alter their behavior? What would you do? Yes.
I think that, like, kind of what the video is saying, like, prisons, like, in America are so overcrowded, and, like, they're not, it's not really, like, any reform kind of program. It's just a put it away and keep it away kind of situation, and not actually dealing with it. But, like, also, especially, like, with, like, the legalization of marijuana and stuff, when they went back on all of these charges that people were just sitting in jail for, like, possession for something completely nonviolent, for using a substance.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, I think that if we did focus more on reform, like, if we did something like halfway houses, things like that.
Okay, so you're saying not necessarily the prison itself, right?
I think that it depends on, like, the offenses.
Okay, we're saying here just for carjackers.
Just for carjackers?
Just carjackers, right? This is an issue, right? We'd all be a victim potentially or something like this. So this is the question, what should we do about this? How should we punish these individuals? How do we alter their behavior altogether? Yeah.
I don't really know if this fits as, like, punishment or it doesn't, but I think of it as like the behavior of carjacking is more of a symptom of something else. So like reform and revise, like they should have a public school system and like make the transit better and like give opportunities to the communities to be successful so that they're not resorting to carjacking to do whatever it is to do the carjack cars. I don't know.
The other thing is just systemic behavioral change, huh?
Yeah.
We're talking about like, well, okay, we need to change things to more education. You said something about transportation?
Yeah, just like improving the CTA safety and reliability and where it can go.
Transit. Okay. Anyone else to think of anything creative? What can we do to punish the carjackers in order to change their behavior besides just lock them up because you're going to have to
I think maybe if like they showed people like the effect that it had on another person, like when you carjack someone's car, they're either like stealing something in it or they're stealing.
So you're saying exposure therapy?
Like yeah.
Exposing them to their own offenses?
It's also like easier for them to do something when they're not thinking about the person they're affecting. But just like you said, like a lot of it comes from like a necessary feel like you need to survive, you need to get money somehow kind of thing.
Yeah, we can say potentially this, it was usually just like a learned behavior, right? Remember we say really when we're talking about any sort of conditioning, outbreak or classical conditioning, we say really we're not even learning, we're just changing behavior. Learning is changing behavior, right? So learned behavior kind of goes together. So maybe it's not even for the means of survival, right? Maybe they're doing, they'll be able to survive without taking a car, essentially, right? But this is good, exposure therapy. Why would exposure therapy be good? Where you say, well, maybe they're actually unaware, right? Many people are unaware or unconscious about what they're doing. They're unconscious about the acts in which they commit. Therefore, you say, maybe we could have some exposure therapy, let them replay what they've done to someone, bring in those victims, let them hear how it felt, stories, and maybe that'll make them a little bit more conscious of their own actions or behavior in some way. Potentially, yes.
I think you increase the punishment when you make it a little more. You change the risk reward. Where the risk is higher than the reward of stealing the car, and you broadcast or educate and make an example of the people that do carjack and tell everyone else not to by making an example out of them.
So greater punishment versus the reward of carjack. So Darren, you're saying that socially we should be tougher on the crime. Because it keeps, the behavior keeps displaying itself because the perpetrators know the severity is not that bad, right? Interesting, which probably would work. Remember we said punishment is actually more effective than reward, right? So if you were to hand out some very, very lengthy sentences that might stop the potential behavior because now the punishment is so severe versus reward. Yes.
I was also thinking like you want to take the approach of like making greater punishment. Like on the victim side, carjacking is normally ends up being more of like a financial burden than anything. So instead of putting them in prison for 20 years or stealing a car, just make it like DUI where like there's a financial punishment, like they have to pay like a
financial punishment, which is really negative reinforcement, right? You know, take away money, potential earnings.
My only thought with that is like if they're already struggling and then
yeah,
they get that big fine, they're just gonna do it again.
Yeah. Like will they pay the fine?
Yeah.
Interesting. But this is a major problem, and we have a lot of people in our field trying to address what to do about it. We see some of this works in Europe, right, in terms of closing the prisons down, being a little bit more lax, or creating new institutions to harbor these individuals, which appears to be effective in Europe. I don't know necessarily so, this will be effective here in the United States. And the culture plays a very, very big part. But this is an ongoing discussion, so just think of some more creative ways throughout your time. Because this is something that's not going on. All right, what time is it?
48.
Okay, let's see. All right, so let's say punishment usually works quickly, more quickly than extinction. Timeout is given an example as a form of negative punishment. And we'll end up with this, how to punish. Punishment immediately follows target response, most important with lower functioning people. Lower functioning people, we could even say some of the criminals may be lower functioning in some ability. Punishment happens each time behavior is displayed, so it needs to be continuous and consistent. And can also lead to rapid reappearance of behavior once punishment is continued. So we saw with extinction, things can reappear and come back if we don't persistently suppress those sort of behaviors. All right, we'll end off here, and that would be it for today. All right, everyone, have a good weekend. I will see you on Monday.
I have a question about the homework of the assignment 5.
Yeah.
It says number 1 suggested activity, page 172, but it's like a class video.
That one for
yeah.
Assignment 5?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, we'll skip that one. Skip that one, and I'll see if I can find another one. So that's number 5?
Yeah.
Okay.
What
is that the influence assignment number 5?
Yeah.
Yeah, influence assignment number 5. Everyone, so you can skip that one. That one is a class sort of group thing, and maybe what I'll have everyone do is we'll do like a group thing.